teams of 2018, please welcome Team MCJD with Caitlin Passera, Maureen Lynch, Jenna.
Hours of ironing, spinning them into an effortless spiral. Eyelashes flutter as a mascara brush swipes across the strands. A glob of the stuff gets stuck in the hair, weighing it down. Dabbing, quickly correcting the mistake, looking for someone who might notice, but in her childhood bathroom, there is nowhere to hide. She turns once more, surveying her reflection. More product is plastered across the bridge of her nose, setting it a seamless, pale tan. The brushes and pots of cosmetics speak of a mess that took hours to create. The hair took twice as long. As she burned the wisps, uncaring of how damaged it was becoming, only knowing that even though she could still smell the smoldering fluff, it would all be worth it. Nothing perfume can't fix. Mini black dress grips her skin like a tightened fist. Suffocation was never a consideration, and now, as she gasps softly, feeling this 21st century corset compress her ribcage, all she can see is how her curves flow like water thanks to this dress. Tights and pumps sheath the legs and feet, blisters already forming on the backs of the heels, blood seeping through the permeable fabric. She shifts a little, but can still feel as the skin is worn and peeled away from the body. Mama's stolen earrings dangle loosely. They threaten to slide and fall, metal and gravity conspiring to ruin her look. Gaudy necklace chokes her throat. Chunky fake diamonds, dip-dyed crimson, all remaining paint washed away by the credit card bill with the chain still laced across the paper. She spins this once more in the mirror, stumbling in her too tall shoes. Gripping the countertop, she surveys her reflection long and hard. One night. It might only be one night, but it was worth too much. She would waltz in, and for once, people would not look away, but towards the beauty in borrowed big sister's dress, stolen jewelry, and vague face. But they wouldn't look away. A single perfect crystal spills, rolling down the cheek, ruining the perfection, combination of foundation, concealer, and blush, no match for less than a millimeter of salt water. Worn from the pain of a girl on the inside, screaming to let her out, but that girl is swallowed down, put away in the closet for another time. Because tonight, the world is open to her. Beautiful like she always wanted to be. Because tonight, she dies for what she wants and is reborn into a grotesque phoenix. Thank you.
Until one day, it just keels over and dies. I'm tired of that yippity-yapping people who are so high and mighty, and because they're so deep, no one could ever possibly understand them or their views. Well, unless they were some obscure artist or playing a grunge band. I'm tired like a saxophone that can't hit the right notes, falling and crumbling to the ground in a messy heap. I'm tired of knowing that I will never be good enough in my parents' eyes, that even if I delivered their world's greatest desires on a golden plate, something would still be a little off. I'm tired like a puppy running, padding in every direction, hearing with toned ears what I am and what I am not. Shouldn't that be for me to decide? So what if I choose to wear slides and basketball shorts? And so what if I don't wear makeup and look as tired as I feel? I'm just trying my best to push through these endless days. Mom, Dad, you say you love me, you say you support me, but what's gonna happen when I go my own way? When I stop acting like you, Dad? When I stop doing everything you say, Mom? Will you still feel the same when it's really time to grow? I'm tired of being muted, my personality silenced by those who don't even take the time to know me. She's so annoying, she's just so weird. Take some time and sift some more. Maybe you'll find what you're looking for. I'm tired of apologizing all the effing time, but my past transgressions will not let it slide. I'm tired of the shaking in my hands and how my throat gets caught, gravel pulsing through my veins where my blood used to take hold. Not to mention how exhausting my labored, anxiety-ridden breath gets while I'm performing on stage. I don't want to say I hate the world, but honestly, sometimes it feels as though I have no choice. I'm tired of the fact that I feel so helpless in my own life, like a prisoner chained in a damn dank dungeon. And I'm tired of the fact that I don't try to defend myself enough. Well, this is me taking a stand with words in my fist to tell the world that enough is enough. And maybe, just maybe, I'll get some rest tonight.
So we have a 9.2, 9.7, a 9. 9.2, 9.3, and a 9.8.
As I step off the plane and breathe in that fresh California air, I feel at home. Finally defrosting from the bitter Connecticut weather, I turn to my girlfriend and smile. I get to show her my favorite place in this world. Walking through the airport, I thought about all the places I'd bring her to. I think of Pier 39 and the sea lions, a reminder of her fat dog Cyrus and her love of the ocean. I think of the Golden Gate Bridge and how many pictures she'll take. I think of the soft sand and chilling waves of the beach where I know her pale nose would turn reddish pink from the hot sun. I think of the way that everybody in California brings their dog everywhere and how she'll try to pet every single one of them. I think of my little brothers and how I hope their goofy high energy isn't too much for them. Most importantly, I think of how I get to share my favorite place with my favorite person, and I hope she likes it too.
Doesn't that just warm your heart, Brian?
Yes. Yes, it does.
So we've got... Okay, we've got a 7.5.
Second shift and I'd secretly stay up late to hear you come through the door? And do you remember that when you'd come through that door, I'd run down the stairs and jump into your arms? I remember. I also remember that when you'd get mad at me, you'd scream and tell me I wasn't your daughter anymore, even though I was just a bright-eyed six-year-old. I remember how many holes you put in the walls of our house through your fits of rage when your face was beet red and your screams were so violent that spit splattered on whoever was within 10 feet. I remember being so scared that one day your aggressive hollow threats would no longer be hollow. and I remember the day we found out just how horrible you are. You couldn't even tell your wife, who you've been with since she was 17, to her face that your girlfriend existed as you sent her the text that made her world come crashing down. I held her as she cried, wondering what she did wrong since she was the one that tried. I'm not going to lie, I was slightly relieved. Relieved that someone so angry would no longer be around to chase me down the hall while yelling threats no one should hear from their father. And though I'm still happy you're not around, you're screwing over your family and you don't even care. You leave my mother to pay for every bill, every little grocery, every bit of necessities, but her one measly bi-weekly paycheck isn't enough to support three people and two dogs while paying the rent for our house. You don't care that we're struggling, and I know this for a fact, because when I told you how I hate feeling like such a bum and how you're leaving us out to dry, you told me to grow up, get over it, get a job. See, you're not my dad, you're just my father, a person who helped create me. A dad would have played catch with his son and done arts and crafts with his daughter. A dad would have showed up to at least one of his daughter's chorus concerts or art shows in her life. A dad would have been there. But I guess there is one thing you taught me. You taught me what kind of person not to be. And I hope that as you walk away, you remember your little princess, your Jenna Bean. I hope you remember what you're losing from the daughter you left behind. P.S. I got a job and I start college in August, and I did it without your help. Is that grown up enough for you?
So we had a 9.4, a 9.6, 9.5, a 10, a 10,